Professor Dave here. I want to tell you about Stokes' Theorem.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Previously, we went over Green's Theorem, which let us turn the line integral for a closed curve C in two dimensions into a double integral. Stokes' Theorem can be thought of as a higher dimensional version, when we have a closed curve in three dimensions, where the curve is the boundary of a surface S. Just as with Green's Theorem, we assume that the curve is positively oriented, which means the path of the curve goes in the counterclockwise direction with respect to the normal vector of the surface. Now, if we have a vector field permeating space, to find the amount of the field that goes in the direction of the curve, we would need to take the line integral of f along c. Stokes' theorem gives us another method of finding this line integral, which can lead to simpler calculations. The theorem states that the line integral of f along c is equal to the surface integral of the curl of f dot n over the surface S. We discussed how to calculate surface integrals in the previous tutorial, so we have seen that they aren't too difficult to solve. It's just that now we have the extra step of taking a curl. Remember that the curl of a vector field is calculated by taking del cross f, where del was the vector ddx, ddy, ddz. While we can use Stokes' theorem to calculate the line integrals, it can also be used in reverse if we want to find the surface integral of a curl and the boundary is simple enough to calculate. Now let's look at an example. Let's say we have a vector field f equals x, y, z, 0, and we want to find the line integral of f over c, where our curve C is given by the triangle that forms when we connect the points 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1. These points define the plane x plus y plus z equals 1, which will be useful information in our calculation. Using Stokes' theorem, we will calculate the line integral as the surface integral of the curl of f dot the normal vector of our plane surface. With the knowledge that the plane is given by x plus y plus z equals 1, we can solve for z to get the parametric representation of the surface. Since z equals 1 minus x minus y, our surface can be represented by r equals x, y, 1 minus x minus y. Now recall that when our surface has z expressed as a function of x and y, we can use a simplified expression. The surface integral of a vector field, in this case the curl of f dot n ds, will equal the double integral of the curl of f dot the cross product of rx and ry dx dy. To get rx and ry, we must take the x and y derivatives of the r vector. So rx equals 1, 0, negative 1, and ry equals 0, 1, negative 1. Now we must calculate the curl of f and the cross product rx cross ry. The curl of f is del cross f, which means we must take the determinant of this matrix. We end up getting I 0 minus 1 minus J 0 minus 0 plus K 0 minus X, which simplifies to negative 1, 0, negative X. Now for Rx cross Ry, we take the determinant of this matrix. Here we get I 0 plus 1 minus j, negative 1, minus 0, plus k, 1, minus 0, which is simply 1, 1, 1. Plugging both of these in, we end up with the double integral of negative 1, 0, negative x, dot 1, 1, 1, dx, dy. Calculating the dot product, we get the double integral of negative 1, minus x, dx, dy. Now we just need to determine our bounds of integration. If we look at our surface again, we see that it is over this triangular region in the xy plane, the border of which is the line between 1, 0 and 0, 1. This line is given by y equals 1 minus x, and we must return to our thought process of setting up bounds for double integrals. We will choose to integrate over y first, which means our range of y goes from the lower curve to the higher curve. So in this case, y runs from 0 to 1 minus x. Meanwhile, x will simply run from 0 to 1. Now our integral is completely set up and we can easily evaluate it. Integrating over y, we see that there is no current dependence on the variable, so the antiderivative is negative 1 minus x, y, which runs from 0 to 1 minus x. Plugging in the upper bound, we get the integral of negative 1 minus x times 1 minus x dx. Multiplying these binomials, we get the integral of negative 1 plus x minus x plus x squared dx, which simplifies to the integral of x squared minus 1 dx. Taking the antiderivative gives us x cubed over 3 minus x, where x runs from 0 to 1. Plugging in these values gives us the quantity 1 third minus 1 minus the quantity 0 minus 0, which is simply negative 2 thirds. This is our line integral, which we used Stokes' theorem to help calculate. Stokes' theorem is a powerful tool that allows us to choose the simplest way to calculate line integrals and some surface integrals. Naturally, many problems will require much more thought and consideration than the simple case we've gone over here, but we've still laid down the groundwork for future endeavors. So let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.